الرحمن الرحيم الحمد لله رب العالمين والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه أجمعين أما بعد. Today is our final khatira for the tafsir of Surah Al-Fatiha, and we have basically one point before we summarize the entire surah, and that is a fiqhi point, a fiqhi or a legal position. And before we conclude Surah Al-Fatiha, we need to talk about the necessity of reciting Surah Al-Fatiha in the Salah, and what is the position of the ulama regarding reciting Surah Al-Fatiha. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, before I begin the fiqh discussion, I need to say, as I've said many times before, all of you should be aware there are four schools of Sunni law: the Shafi'is, the Hanbalis, the Hanafis, the Malikis. And all of these schools of law are legitimate, and we should not cause any division or criticize any of these. All of these are legitimate expressions. So if you wish to stick to your school of law, alhamdulillah, no problem with that. And if you wish to ask somebody what his or her position is, and you wish to follow that position, that too is acceptable. With that disclaimer, realize that the issue of reciting Fatiha, there are some areas where all scholars are agreed. If you're praying by yourself, then by all of the madhahib, you must recite Fatiha in every rak'ah. You cannot have a salah without reciting Fatiha in every single rak'ah. And this is based upon the authentic hadith of the Prophet ﷺ, لَا صَلَاتَ لِمَنْ لَمْ يَقْرَأْ بِأُمِّ الْكِتَابِ أَوْ بِفَاتِحَ الْكِتَابِ. Explicit hadith. There is no salah. لَا صَلَاتَ. There is no salah for the one who does not recite the Fatiha. So, all of the madhahib agree that if you are praying by yourself, or you are the imam of a congregation, that you must recite Fatiha in every single rak'ah of every single salah. Fard salah, sunnah salah, nafil salah, the salah of shukr, the salah of rain, the salah of fear, the salah of Eid, every type of salah, the salah of janazah, you must recite Fatiha as well, because it is a salah. So every salah that we pray, we read Surah Al-Fatiha in the salah. So what is the controversy then? The huge controversy that exists from the time of the Sahaba, it's nothing new, goes back to the Sahaba themselves. Some companions held one view, other companions held another view. So this ikhtilaf has been going on for 14 centuries. What is the controversy? When you are behind the imam, right now, you are praying behind an imam. Now what should you do? This is the area of controversy. Not when you're praying by yourself, not when you are the imam. When you're praying behind the imam, what should you do? There's a number of opinions. Very simplistically, the Hanafi school of law says that at any instance, whether the imam is reciting out loud or quietly, you do not recite Fatiha. So the Hanafi position is the one behind the imam does not recite Fatiha in any circumstance whatsoever. On the exact other side of the spectrum, you have the Shafi'i school. And the Shafi'i school says, you must recite Fatiha in every salah behind the imam. And this is not the Shafi'i position, this is the position of the Zahiri madhab, it's the position of Abu Huraira the companion, and other of the Sahaba as well, that you need to recite the Fatiha in every single rak'ah. Whether the imam is out loud, such as right now in Isha, in Fajr, or the imam is silent, such as Dhuhr and Asr, you must recite Fatiha. This is the Shafi'i position. So this is the two extremes on the one side, then you have the middle position. So you have the Hanafi position on the one side, never recite. You have the Shafi'i position on the other side, recite every time. Then you have the Maliki and the Hanbali position in the middle. And that is, in the quiet prayers you recite. What are the quiet prayers? Dhuhr and Asr. And also the quiet rak'ahs, right? So the last two rak'ahs of Isha. And the loud prayers, when you're hearing the imam, you don't recite. So this position basically says, if you can hear the imam recite Fatiha, then his recitation counts for your recitation. And this position is the majority position, and they base it on many evidences of them, is that the Qur'an says, وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُ لَهُ وَأَنصِتُ. When the Qur'an is recited, then listen to it and be quiet, so that Allah can have mercy on you. And Imam Ahmad says, this verse was revealed because the Sahaba were reciting in the prayer, so Allah revealed this verse. So he makes a tafsir of this verse. This verse applies to the salah. وَإِذَا قُرِئَ الْقُرْآنُ فَاسْتَمِعُوا لَهُ وَأَنصِتُ. Also there's an authentic hadith, Bukhari and Muslim, that our Prophet sallallahu alayhi wasallam said, the imam has been made to be followed. إِنَّمَا جُعِلَ الْإِمَامُ لِيُؤْتَمَّ بِهِ. The imam has been made to be followed. So when he says Allahu Akbar, you say Allahu Akbar.
And when he recites, you listen. And when he goes into the court, you go into the court, and the hadith goes on all the way. But when he recites, what should you do? وَإِذَا قَرَأَ فَأَنصِتُ. This hadith is authentic, it's in Sahih Muslim. When he recites, you be quiet and you listen to that. And also, they base this on other evidences as well, of them being that, how can a person behind the imam recite when the imam is reciting? How can the person behind the imam recite when the imam is reciting? Either he misses the second portion of the recitation or whatnot. So this is the majority position. It is also the position of Ibn Taymiyyah, rahimahullah ta'ala. And also, they say that the whole point of saying Ameen, the whole point of saying Ameen, when the imam finishes Fatiha, what do? We say Ameen. Ibn Kathir and others, they say, when you say Ameen, it is as if you have done the Fatiha as well. Because that's the whole point of saying Ameen. That, oh Allah, me too. I want this as well. So this is the stamp as well. In any case, as I said at the beginning of this talk, whatever position you follow, alhamdulillah, these positions have been around for 14 centuries. So if you want to follow the Hanafi position, the Shafi'i position, the Maliki or the Hanbali position, all of this, insha'Allah ta'ala, is legitimate. Now, my dear brothers and sisters, just to summarize and to conclude, this surah, as we know, we go back all the way to the very beginning. Our Prophet ﷺ called it the Ummul Qur'an, meaning the mother of the book, or we said the gist of the book. The surah is a summary of our entire religion. And that is why it is required for every single musalli to recite, and Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala chose it to be the beginning of the Qur'an. It begins with the statement of fact that all unconditional praise is due to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala alone. He is our Lord. He is our caretaker. He is our nourisher. He is our sustainer. All that we have, He is the Rabb. All that we have comes from Him. He is unique. We are the Alameen. We are not unique. He does not need us. We need Him. He is the Rabbul Alameen. We don't need Him. He does not need us. We need Him. And therefore, we love Him because He is worthy of being loved and adored and worshipped. And our Lord, our Rabb, is a merciful Lord. He's a Lord of compassion. He's a Lord of kindness. He's a Lord of forgiveness. He is Rahman by nature, and He shows His mercy, Rahim. At the same time, because He is merciful, He has also revealed to us a set of laws. And those laws must be followed. And those who follow them or don't follow them, there will be a reckoning. There will be a judgment day. And so even though our Lord is merciful and we hope for His mercy, we are also terrified at His wrath and anger for those who deserve it. There will be a day of reckoning, and that day He will be the judge. He will be the Malik. He will be the Malik. He will be the King. He will legislate, and nobody can rescind that legislation. And He is a just Lord. No one will be treated with injustice on that day. So if we know we have a Lord like that, what should we do? We acknowledge verbally and through our actions, our tongues and our bodies, that we will worship You, O Allah. إِيَّاكَ نَعْبُدْ. We're going to worship You and You alone, because You are worthy of being worshipped. And we acknowledge that, O Allah, we need Your help for everything that we do. إِيَّاكَ نَسْتَعِينَ. We cannot lift a finger without You willing and helping it. So we seek His help in each and every issue of our affairs. And what is the most important help? What is the most important need that we have? We want to be rightly guided. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. We want to be upon the path of His chosen servants. A path that is well traveled. A path that is level and clear. A path that is the path of the prophets and the martyrs and the saints and the righteous people. Because there are many paths. And we want the level, straight path that leads to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. We know there are other paths as well. We don't want to be on those other paths. We don't want to be upon the path of those upon whom anger has been shown because of their insolence, because of their arrogance. For there are people in this world who know the truth and they willingly reject it. They know what is truth, but their arrogance is too big to accept the truth. So we don't want to be like them. We wish to act upon the knowledge that we have. There are other people as well who don't know the truth. They're trying to find the truth. So they're good intentioned, but they don't know the path. We don't want to be amongst them as well. Their intentions alone will not save them because they're still searching for the path. So we seek refuge in Allah from being amongst غير المغضوب عليهم on the one hand and ولا الضالين, because our religion is a religion of knowledge and action, of ilm and amal, and that is the صراط المستقيم. We always make this dua because no matter how much guidance we have, we can always be guided even more. We could be on the periphery of the path. We want to get more and more center. We want to go forward. So we keep on making dua more than 20, more than 30, more than 40 times a day. اِهْدِنَا الصِّرَاطَ الْمُسْتَقِيمِ. For every matter, we want to be upon the straight path. And we keep on making this dua to Allah as we praise Him, as we glorify Him, as we mention His beauty and His excellence. And we keep on mentioning how incapacitated we are without His help. Without Allah, we are nothing. And Allah Azza wa Jal is the one. My dear brothers and sisters, this surah, Surah Al-Fatiha, Allah has compared the entire Quran to it. That Allah says, I have revealed to you the 7 oft-repeated verses and the entire Quran. وَلَقَدْ آتَيْنَاكَ سَبْعًا مِنَ الْمَثَانِي وَالْقُرْآنَ الْعَظِيمِ. It is as if the Quran is equivalent to the entire Surah Al-Fatiha. The 7 verses is the message of the Quran all combined in one. So we now understand just the beginnings, we see the glimmer. And this entire tafsir that took over 20 lessons, wallahi, my dear brothers and sisters, we have just scratched the surface of Surah Al-Fatiha. We could have done much more than this. And no matter how much I did, or no matter how much any scholar of Islam did, we could never fully unravel the secrets and the beauties and the mysteries of the surah. For that is something that only Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala Himself can do. But we just tried a little bit to appreciate the surah that every Muslim recites dozens of times a day. And we want Allah Azza wa Jal to bless us through this surah and with this surah and because of this surah. And we have full hope in Allah, as our Prophet ﷺ said, that if we recite the surah properly, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept it from us. And then He will say, وَلِعَبْدِي مَا سَأَلْ. My servant will get all that he wants. So my dear brothers and sisters, my parting advice to myself and all of you, don't trivialize this surah. Don't zoom through it at supersonic speed. Don't just recite it like a hummingbird buzzing away like the bees. This is a surah that Allah chose. This is a surah that an angel came down and Jibreel was with the Prophet ﷺ, and the angel said that I have never come down to earth. This is the first time I'm coming down, and Allah has sent me to tell you that no prophet has ever gotten a surah like this surah. This is that surah, a blessing that our Prophet Muhammad ﷺ has been given. It is a blessing for our ummah. So let us not trivialize this surah. Let us appreciate this surah. Let us understand it. Let us be amazed at its profundity. Let us appreciate the beauty. And most importantly, let us recite it sincerely from the heart. Perhaps Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will accept our dua. Alhamdulillahi rabbil alameen. Ar-Rahman ar-Rahim. Maliki yawm al-deen. Iyaka na'budu wa iyaka nasta'een. اهدنا الصراط المستقيم صراط الذين أنعمت عليهم غير المغضوب عليهم ولا الضالين آمين وآخر دعوانا الحمد لله رب العالمين والسلام عليكم ورحمة الله وبركاته.